I'm different, yeah, I'm different. I'm different, yeah, I'm different. I'm different, yeah, I'm different. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Middle finger up to my competition. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing. Pull up to the scene with my cylinder missing.
What's up, Stockholm? My name is Danger Dave, and what I do is I make cool wheat. So when I say cool, I want you to say wheat. Cool?
Wheat.
Cool?
Wheat.
So what exactly is cool wheat? Well, thank you. It's the art, large inflatable sculptures like Happy Kanye. You can go inside and make him happy from the inside. And it's the fashion, loud, vibrant clothing, such as what I'm wearing today. And it's the combination of those two things that make me very happy. So before I get into the story of cool shit, I wanted to do a little bit of an experiment with everybody here. And we're gonna need the house lights on. Can we get the house lights, please? Can we get the house lights? Turn them on. I want everybody to pull out a piece of paper and a pen. Probably everyone's, you've still got that stuff, right? With the phones, a piece of paper and a pen. I'm gonna give you 30 seconds. I want you to look at the person on your left, and I would like you to draw them as a pile of poop. Seconds, 5 seconds, 4, 3, and stop. Now share that drawing with the person on your left. How's it looking? Sexy, delicious, tasty. Now, at this point, you're probably wondering, Danger Dave, that was a lot of fun, but what was the point? And the answer is there was no point at all. And that pretty much is the premise of our body of work, just doing things for the sake of doing it. If you see anything you like, take a photo, share it on Instagram, we're at coolshit, that's where you can find us. I'm originally from Australia, the country that looks like Scooby-Doo. Scooby-Doo. And, you know, I've always had a kind of artistic backbone. I think I've covered myself in Vegemite there. Always been interested in the arts and the performing arts, and I kind of followed that through school and later through university. And then my life took a dark turn when I ended up landing a job in advertising. This is pre-Danger Dave. This is just Douche Dave. This is my closest friend, Ulla, thinking I'm here with Douche Dave. And, you know, I was doing work in the world of advertising, and I was getting paid a lot of money, kind of hacked the system. I was, like, getting paid by the hour, which was great. But I wasn't feeling fulfilled, and I felt like I had more to add and more to do. So around the same time, I saw this talk by this incredible guy, Stefan Sagmeister, and he was talking about the power of taking time off. And in particular, this idea of taking a sabbatical every 7 years, which is something that he still does to this day. So I decided to take a sabbatical for 7 years. And I quit my job, broke up with my girlfriend, and bought a one-way ticket to Barcelona. Now, you're all Swedish, so I know you've all been to Barcelona, right? And I was basically thinking, you know, if it's good enough for Salvador Dali and Pablo Picasso, like maybe, just maybe, it's going to be good enough for Danger Dave. So we started wearing these yellow suits, and everybody I met, everybody I made contact with, I started making them wearing yellow suits, and we started collaborating together and creating these things in the world. More people started wearing the yellow suits, sometimes dressed as bananas, and then eventually we started selling the yellow suits. So a lot of people ask, like, how do I get a yellow suit? I really like the jacket. Where do I get it from? Two ways. You can either collaborate with us on a project, travel with us around the world and do something interesting or remarkable, or you can simply just buy it. That's coolshit.me, shameless plug. There's the button right there. So let's get started. It's time to make some cool wheat. So the most important meal of the day is, oh, this is the before and after photo. There's a few steps in between. So the most important meal of the day is breakfast. In Barcelona, it's always a sticky croissant and a café con leche. And we used to start the day, there was a studio, there was three of us in the Gothic quarters in Barcelona, and every day we'd go around sampling different croissants and coffee combos. But one day we found this place, which is called La Pineda, and this place was founded in 1930, and it hasn't changed since 1930, but when we stepped inside, it literally changed our life. Because when we stepped in and asked for a croissant, they said, sorry boys, we don't do croissants, but how about a kilo of raw meat in the format of the butifarra sausage? To which we said, of course. And when we asked for the coffees, they said, we don't have like coffees after 10 a.m. They have this strange policy, but how about a liter of sickly sweet vermouth, which is like this, it's like red wine with added sugar in it, to which we also said, yes, please. So what's interesting about this place is this photo, which is censored, but also the people. These are the founders, these are the owners. This is Antonio on the left with a mustache, Jose on the right without a mustache, they're brothers. The business was given to them by their father. They're probably gonna give it to their kids. And we just had this moment, we felt so special in this place, we wanted to share it, we wanted to share this experience with the world around us. So we decided to create a club, the world's first sausage club, the Butifarra Club, El Club de la Butifarra, Buti Club. And we started creating experiences around that. So we needed members. Jose and Antonio were members number one and two, and we started inviting all our friends, artists, photographers, models, athletes, to be a part of this club. And people just wanted to be a part of it just because it was a sausage club. So we made these t-shirts, very phallic t-shirts with big sausages on them, and created a little photo shoot so we could sell them, mainly in Germany. As a side Booty Club project, Soraya, who's now my wife, we made the world's first, we met at Booty Club, now we made the world's first ever booty baby, sausage baby, together, which was amazing, and still is. Thanks, thank you. And, you know, we did other little experiments, like this is the Butifarra Bosque, so we wanted to celebrate the 50 members, so we created 50 sausages in all different shapes and sizes and consistencies, and created this experience where you could kind of walk through and touch and smell and sniff these beautiful sausage creations. And then we made the Butifanda, which is this beautiful object of desire. It's a long sausage scarf, not made from real sausages, of course. And it was just like a funny experience because we had no background in fashion. We wanted to be artists, but we were just kind of starting this journey. And we put up this post on a modeling website saying, who wants to be the face of the sausage? And within 24 hours, like, we had 250 applicants, male and female, who wanted to be a part of it just because they did. So here's a short video to kind of showcase what Booty Club was about. I'm going to point this way.
Damas y caballeros, bienvenido a Booty Club. El club dedicado a la celebración de la vida, la guitarra, el amor, la moda, el arte y la butifarra.
I like big butts and I cannot lie.
Well, you get the idea. I'm going to make everything shorter, including the videos. What we learned from this was this idea, like, this could have been one of those ideas that we just kind of scrawled on the back of a napkin after drinking a liter of sickly sweet wine and washing it down with raw sausages. It could have been one of those ideas that died on the tablecloth, but we decided to do something with it. We shipped it, and we brought it into the world for better or worse and created something new and special. So that's definitely some cool wheat. Cool wheat. So at this point, we had some commercial projects and no one cared about them. And we had this sausage club and everyone in Barcelona wanted to be a member. It was a really strict membership policy. There were only 50 members and it was literally like one in, one out. So you had to wait for somebody to die before you could enter. Everyone wanted to be a part of the club. We were getting like lots of attention in blogs and magazines. Canal Plus from France came down and they made a documentary about it. And we realized that we had to do more things like that. Without any business model, without any like reason or rationale why, it was just like an intuition that we had to do something with it. So we created this manifesto, keep it simple, make money, think big, play, and cool quit, of course. And we were referencing, you know, Jeff Koons, and we're thinking about his work, like his large, playful work, such as POOPIE, which is in Bilbao. And we're also thinking about the guys from Odd Future, because they were basically traveling around the world with their music, having fun and playing. So we kind of wanted it to be like a Jeff Koons Odd Future mashup. That was our reference point. So we had the Sausage Club, and it only really had attention in Barcelona and Germany, because no one else cares about sausages. We wanted to create something that would impact more people and get to a larger audience. So I'd like you to say hello to our next project, which is Lionel Richie's Head. So who's a fan of Lionel Richie for his music? Hands up. A few of you. That's pretty good. Okay, so we don't care so much about his music, but what was interesting were these memes that were circulating around 2012-13, the Rich Tea Biscuits, the Hello Is It Tea You're Looking For, and the Lost and Found posters. And in particular, we wanted to create something that referenced this incredible film clip from 1982, directed by Bob Giraldi, in which Lionel Richie is the teacher, and his student, who is blind, falls in love with him and creates this. Hello. Oh, I skipped too much. This.
Oh, it's wonderful.
Oh, it's wonderful. Yes, it is wonderful. So the idea was to put inside this head a telephone that would have two states. It would either be ringing, and when you picked it up, it would say...
Hello. Is it me you're looking for?
Yeah, so we had a concept, and we thought this idea was too big to sit in an art gallery, and we had this theory that music festivals were the new art gallery anyway, because it's way more interesting to engage with 30,000 people who are drunk and high at a music festival than in a small, white-cubed art gallery. So we reached out to Rob the Bank, who has this festival, amazing festival called Bestival in the Isle of Wight. It's an island off the coast of England. And we told him about the project, and he said, whatever you need, I've got you. I want to see this head at my festival, but I won't give you any money for it. So we put the project on Kickstarter. You know, people were using Kickstarter to create useful things, you know, technology that people actually need in their lives. We used it to raise £8,000 to build Lionel Richie's head.
And some people should be in jail because a Kickstarter did meet its goal, like this one, for an actual giant inflatable Lionel Richie
like
head.
Cutting off.
You two gentlemen should be locked up all night long. All night. All night. All night long. All night. All night. Hey, Jumba Jumba.
Sorry that the video looks so short. Anyway.
Hey, Jumba Jumba.
Hey, Jumba Jumba. So we raised the money, and just a little look at like our creative process. Started with a meme. We always work with people who are more talented than us, which isn't hard. This is Alex Sans Marceau, who recreated the head in clay. We then painted it by hand ourselves, and we contacted these balloon manufacturers in Milan and said, can you make this? They said they could, and 2 days before the festival, they sent us albino Lionel Richie, which was a little bit embarrassing. So, you know, our artistic career was about to be over before it even started. Fortunately, our friend Stefano Fenn stepped in, and he's a master painter, and within 3 hours created this, which looks more like Lionel Richie. Of course, inside there's a telephone, it's got a little Arduino board, it's got the two states, it's either ringing or when you pick it up, it says,
hello, is it me you're looking for?
And yeah, it was a success. So we had a queue 2 hours deep, people were skipping out on Elton John and Wu-Tang Clan Ain't Nothing to Fuck With, just to get inside and find out what was going on. And the results spoke for themselves. People came out crying, some people came out laughing. There was a pirate who came out and tried to punch me in the face because he was looking for treasure and all he found was a telephone. These are the guys who backed it. Adam and Christian for £1,000 for the privilege of sleeping inside Lionel Richie's head for the duration of the festival. glamping inside Lionel. So here's a quick video to show you that.
Hello. Is it me you're looking for?
Hello, can you tell me what's in his head?
Love.
Passion.
Looks very cool.
I think if you open it up, there'll be like hearts coming out.
You go in it and then there's things in there and, well, you just don't know what happens.
Boom. So that was Lionel Richie's head. For a minute, we stopped being known as the Yellow Jacket crew and we were known as the Lionel Richie Head crew. And we got flown out to Miami to do Lionel Richie Head clay workshop, which was amazing. And then the irony, that's the real Lionel Richie. The irony went full circle because Lionel Richie found out about his own head, and he obviously loved the concept, and he publicly promoted it on Facebook. I seriously love this idea, Lionel Richie's head, outrageous, exclamation mark, exclamation mark, exclamation mark. His team reached out to us. They wanted the head for one of his shows in Hyde Park in London. To which we said, no, thank you. And then they reached out to us again because his daughter, Nicole Richie, wanted to use the head in the show, being Nicole, to which we also said, no, thank you. But this project was really all about the hustle. It was one of those things that nobody came out and gave this to us. Nobody gave this opportunity to us. We just had an idea, and we just, like, flexed that hustle muscle and fought to make it happen. And that's some cool huit. Cool huit. So we got reached out by the Art Directors Club in New York, and they had this concert. They wanted to do an exhibition. They wanted to bring the art and craft out of the advertising agencies. And we wanted to make a cat that had laser beam eyes called Laser Cat. So we married those two ideas together and created Laser Cat.
The ADC 2014 is the year of the Laser Cat.
I am Laser Cat.
His laser beam eyes can project art onto walls.
You get the idea. So, creative process. Started with a GIF. It's a cat with laser beam eyes. And on the way to the studio every day, we'd walk past this $2 shop, and it just had like a window of lucky cats. So one day I just bought a lucky cat, decapitated it, put the head in a box, and sent it off. Didn't work with the Milan guys anymore because they were rubbish. Found this team in Los Angeles, and they came back with this. This is the head. Of course, inside, we filled it with lasers, and a lot of people were kind of skeptical of that, putting these ultra-high-beam, retina-burning lasers inside this flammable plastic cat. But we did it anyway, and nobody died, which was very fortunate. And this is, one of the shows, to give you a sense for it. This is in Washington, D.C., so it's basically just a big crowd of people, lots of smoke, because you don't have lasers unless you have smoke. And the project was interactive on two levels. One is we collected people's art and turned it into GIFs. So we had feedlasercat.com. People submitted whatever they wanted, and we kind of gifted it and created these amazing animations from it. And then we had this little hacked-together red button on stage. We invited people up. They pushed the button, changed the art, changed the lasers, changed the music, and in a sense changed the world. So this was the show. This is in New York. We got a lot of press for it. We traveled to a lot of different places with this project. Very, very proud of it. Simultaneously, this, we created this car. This is our poopmobile. This is how we get around in Barcelona. We created Mr. Poopie. The concept is that the ice cream emoji and the poop emoji, they're actually the same thing. So we created Mr. Poopie. He could climb in through his mouth and eat chocolate ice cream. We created Big Bird. Oh, I'm just going all over the shop. Big Bird was sampled basically the biggest bird we could find, Big Bird from Sesame Street. We wanted to do this big group gunge because, the superstition when a bird takes a shit on you, it's good luck. So everybody got gunged. And we put Nicolas Cage in a cage, which is quite frankly where he belongs. We made some Snoop Dogg hot dogs because it just makes sense, right? Snoop Dogg hot dogs. I got to meet some childhood heroes. This is Eric Hilton from Thievery Corporation. Like, he DJed one of our shows. I got to hang out with Casey Neistat. And I finally got to meet like Stefan Sagmeister, who was the person who accidentally put me on that path to take a 7-year sabbatical and start creating cool shit. But then something happened, the phone stopped ringing. Didn't actually have a phone that looked like that, but it stopped ringing. And we didn't have any clients, because we'd kind of fired all our clients to pursue these artistic projects, because I wanted to be an artist. But we didn't have any money, because we didn't have any clients, and then I couldn't pay my team, because we didn't have any money. So my team left, I couldn't pay myself, obviously I couldn't leave, although I would have if I could have, but I couldn't. And you know, at this point I have two like butifarra babies now, and a little bit more, kind of a few more responsibilities, and it was a bit of a low point for me, and I was looking at this quote from Andy Warhol, which is making money is art, and we weren't making money, which meant that we couldn't make art. So in a sense, I kind of succeeded on my goal because I wanted to be an artist, but I kind of left out or neglected the business side and the making money side because I didn't realize that they went hand in hand. So that was just definitely some just wheat without the cool bit. And I had a bit of a reality check moment. So I started taking the business more seriously, registered a limited company in the UK, fired my existing accountant, found a better accountant, started using some better accounting software, started using some like software to help manage all these inbound leads, because I'd meet people all the time that wanted to make cool shit with me, but I had no system for following it up and, you know, turning it into work. So now I kind of do that, and I have a more, you know, systemized approach to that. And I basically just reached out to everybody that I knew in the advertising world and got some amazing opportunities that came in. We built a stand for Volkswagen in Barcelona, which is incredible. This band called Flake, this Danish band called Flake, they came to us. They wanted to build a stage for Roskilde with us. One of the owners, Mads, has this little dog, which is a chow chow. So we made a giant chow chow and 100 1-meter bones that we threw out into the audience. And now we're doing some commercial work with Vice and MTV. And I think the main lesson from that is this idea, like, never give up. If you have an idea, if you're passionate about something, if you care about something, like, you got to fight and maybe pivot a little bit and find a way to make it a reality. So I want to share with you this sentence slide and also this one that says cool shit, and just end this presentation with the last project, one of the last projects we created, because we had a fresh start and a fresh opportunity to create more art. And that
I miss the old Kanye, straight from the gold Kanye. Chop up the soul Kanye, set on his goals Kanye. I hate the new Kanye, the bad mood Kanye, the always rude Kanye, spazzing the news Kanye.
So Kanye is sad, and we wanted to make him happy. And here's a little video. Yes. 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 Yes, all right. Is the disco ball inside the unicorn? Good, good. What about Mr. Poopy? Fits in there too? Perfect. I gotta go. Bye. Oh, hi. I'm Danger Dave. Here at Hungry Castle, we turn the internet into real life. Let me show you. Wow. It's simple, really. We start with our favorite memes, such as Sad Kanye, and then we turn them into large interactive experiences. You get the idea. So we wanted to fill his head with objects that would make him happy. All these ideas, is it gonna be like floating cash inside? Maybe there's a coffee club. Maybe it's just like this meta, like Kanye kissing Kanye inside and you can get involved, or Kanye karaoke. And in the end, we're like, you know, we knew the sculpture was gonna be really big. It was 13 meters wide, 7 meters tall. And we're like, what could possibly be big enough to fill this big empty cavity? What could we put inside? And we decided to fill it with his big ego. So we created this sound toy. Here's a little bit of the process. So this is the original meme that it's based on, Sad Kanye. This is the image we wanted to share at the music festival in Australia, where we got the funding to actually build this bad boy. And you know, a bit of creative process. This is me, like, very basic Photoshop, literally just two layers here, cutout head and a rainbow. Always work with people who are more talented with me, so 3D artists who kind of created this 3D form, and then now we work with a really dedicated team in Hong Kong who build whatever we want, whatever we need. And this is the piece, really hyper-realistic details on the face. We've obviously evolved and developed a long way since the first projects. And, you know, people, what do they do with public art? They take photos of it, you know, they want to share the selfie. But this particular piece, you can go inside, and we created his ego, which coincidentally is shaped like a penis. And you can play with it, and basically we cut up all these sound bites, because, you know, Kanye West is like a musical instrument in his own right, so we cut up all these sound bites of him going like, And, you know, as you touched his ego, which is coincidentally shaped like a penis, it would light up from the inside and go, So that was the experience. This image is censored. This is the piece. You know, it's really funny, like public art, you have this experience where you're creating something on screen, you're building it, but the final test is like when you put it out into the world and see how people respond to it. And Kanye is like a really polarizing dude. So, you know, people all over the world, we took this piece to Australia, Byron Bay, Australia. We were in the UK. And then we were at Art Basel, Miami last December. And it didn't matter where we were, people would walk past. And because he's got a hyper-realistic face, they'd go, holy shit, that is Kanye West. And then from there, it would either go two ways. They'd go, I love Kanye West. And they kind of run up to him and kiss him and hug him. Or they go, I hate Kanye West. And they'd be like throwing apples at him. Or in Australia, somebody tried to set fire to his nose. So it's just interesting to see how people respond to things differently. So, you know, I just want to end this presentation on saying that now, like on a personal level, I have a new challenge because I want to be an artist and I've kind of achieved that, but I also need to wear this hat of being a business person, and sometimes I need to wear a hat of just being a janitor cleaning sticky milkshake off Kanye West's nose. So I'm an artist, a business person, a janitor, and I'd like to end this presentation by saying everybody in this room is an artist, and I'd like to implore you and encourage you all to go out and create some art. Share something interesting with the world. Thank you, guys. You've been amazing. Stockholm, you're incredible. Nordic, design. You can find me there. Ciao. Bye.